Good evening. It's lovely to be back with you once again, isn't it, Ronnie?
Indeed it is. And in a packed programme tonight, we shall be meeting the brilliant top civil servant who's got his ear to the ground, his nose to the grindstone, his shoulder to the wheel, his eye on the clock, his hand in the till, his back to the wall, his foot in the door and his finger on the button. And we'll be asking him how he does his flies up.
We'll also be hearing about the explorer, who's also a bit of a contortionist and got lost in the back of his own beyond.
But first, the news. The search for Twilton Gumboots, Britain's most childish criminal, will be getting underway very shortly when police have closed their eyes and counted up to 100.
Her Majesty the Queen had a heavy cold today and cancelled a royal walkabout. She stayed in and read the telephone directory instead.
And it's been a sad day for Walton Shrubs, the lonely bachelor who joined a computer dating agency because he couldn't chat up girls. Now he's discovered he can't fill in forms either.
Widespread concern was being voiced in the House of Commons today about inadequate height of the furniture. This follows an incident on Monday when a minister ran into the House and tabled his amendments.
And at the exhibition of motorway art, which opened at the Hayward Gallery this morning, an oil painting of the Drive Slowly sign was so realistic that 59 people completely ignored it.
Finally, fears that standards are dropping at the annual cattle show were confirmed today when the Best of Breed prize was won by a tin of oxtail soup.
But now a sketch featuring Mr. Ronnie Corbett, whose wife tries not to bring out the beast in him because she's afraid of mice.
Monte Carlo Robinson. Good heavens, Monte Carlo. I haven't seen you for ages. I'll join you in a minute. Yes.
Monte Carlo? That's a damn funny name, isn't it?
Yes, it was all the rage in those days, you know. One names one's child after the place he or she was, in fact, conceived, as it were. Yes. Apparently the Robinsons had a cracking good time in Monte Carlo. Hence, he's called Monte Carlo.
Yeah. Of course. I remember. I know his younger brother.
Really? What's he called?
He's called Monte Carlo as well. They must have gone there every year.
Probably.
Yeah. Yes.
Hello, old chap.
Hello, Nancy. Nancy? He was actually conceived in Norcy, you see. The car broke down on the way to Monte Carlo. He's since been anglicised.
Has he?
I mean, and it's now called... It's now called Nancy.
Yes, well, of course, the way cars break down nowadays, there must be Nancy boys everywhere.
Yeah. Hello there, old chap.
Hello, Ramsgate.
Ramsgate? Are you a Ramsgate fan, Shaw? Obviously, your parents couldn't even wait till they got on the ferry.
Tell me, Henshaw, you're not named after the place you were...
No, absolutely not. Certainly not.
A letter, Mr. Fanshaw.
Thank you, Romford. I say, this isn't for me. This is for you, Henshaw.
What?
Not Fanshaw. This is for you. What terrible writing. What is that Christian name?
No, never mind that.
Be patient, my dear. Park Bench.
Good evening. Equality. Now, the government white paper on the Equal Society was published today. Its main provisions are as follows. From April the 1st, 1981, everyone must be of equal height. This height will be 3 foot above the saloon bar for men and 2 foot under the hairdryer for women. Anyone found shorter than the equal height will be looked down upon. He will then be sent to a government height-inducing camp, where he will stand in a barrel of manure until he's tall enough to step out without catching anything on the rusty nail at the top. Everything must also be of equal weight. This weight, everyone, I should say, must be of equal weight. This weight to be established as quite heavy for men and not quite so heavy for women. Except during pregnancy, of course, when women will be permitted a little more. Men, however, will not be permitted anything at all. Now, anyone below equal weight will be forcibly fed with chocolate biscuits through the usual channels. And will receive a silicone injection in the event, or in the arm. If a woman thinks silicone is silly, she can have cortisone instead. If a man has caught his own, he should be more careful with his... All people table must also be of equal colour. There will be a choice of complexion, peaches and cream, salmon and shrimp, or blackberry and custard. No one will be allowed to be more than one colour, except Chinese communists, who will be both red and yellow, Chinese communist honeymoon couples, who will be red, yellow and green, and Chinese communist honeymoon couples who didn't make out, who will be red, yellow, green and blue. Anyone found to be red, yellow, green, black and blue will be deemed to be a Chinese communist honeymoon couple who did make out. Now, I would like to show you a diagram. I would like to, but I can't, as Mrs. Whitehouse might complain. But I'll tell you about it. As from 1985, everyone will be of equal shape. Except, of course, that women will have two of these and one of those. And men will have one of these and two of those. If any man is found to have two of these, he will be declared a woman, whether he has one of those or not. Now, if a man has got one of these but only one of those, he will get a pension. And if he's got two of those and two of those, he won't get a pension, but he will get attention. Believe you me, any man found with three of those will be ostracized. Which is bad news for pawnbrokers. Excuse me. Hello. Oh, hello, Mrs. Whitehouse. You what? You insist on the viewers seeing all these and those? Very well, very well. There we are. Disgusting, isn't it, but true to life. Like crossroads. Now, noses. Noses, there will be a choice of noses, Roman aquiline or hooked turnip. Now, the number of nostrils will remain at two, although there will be a choice, of course, of straight or flared. Members of the public will be allowed to make their choice in their own time, but the House of Commons is to have a special session when members can all pick their noses together. Finally, in future, all children must be born equally. That is, on October the 1st each year. This will be known as Labour Day. To achieve this objective, all television transmissions during the week of December the 23rd will close down at 9 o'clock when everyone will have an early night. And a very happy just before Christmas to you all. Good night.
Dr. Wilson sent my Charlie to see one of them specialists.
Oh, which one was that?
You know, one of them sexologists.
What are you sending him there for?
Well, it's a strange thing, but he says every time he sneezes, he fancies a bit of slap and tickle. Chases me all over the house.
So what did the specialist say then?
Well, he told him to stop.
What, fancying you?
No, taking snuff.
Will you welcome, please, our guest this week, Kiki D.
You're all wanna be. He's better than the rest, won't you let great ports of the world, arteries through which crime can spread its ugly tentacles ever wider as each year passes. Piggy Malone, if not the greatest detective in the world, then certainly one of the largest. And Charlie Farley, even less great, and certainly a lot less large, were no strangers to world crime, as their past records show. Piggy's expertise in the case of the Bombay Duck is still talked about in Indian takeaways, the length and breadth of Hendon. And Charlie Farley dealt with the Phantom of the French Fan as only he could, from the inside. In Marseille, City of Sin, neither of our two heroes managed to find any. Discovering the secret formula on the villainess's undergarments came pretty close to it. But on a certain muggy April morning in northwest London, the fat detective's thoughts were on more mundane matters.
Oh, morning, Charlie.
Ah, morning, Chief.
How's it going?
Not too bad. I've only just started, as a matter of fact. I decided to paint it the same colour again, you know.
Why?
Well, I found this paint down the cellar, you know, left over from last year. I thought, well, I might as well, you know, if it runs out, I won't notice as much, you know.
Is that my apron you're wearing, then?
Yeah, the one you got for Christmas. You don't mind, you?
No, it looks silly on me.
Well, as a matter of fact, it looks a little bit silly on me.
Listen, where's Elsie? I've got to have some coffee. My mouth is like the Caligari Desert.
Oh, Kalahari, Chief. Caligari was that mad doctor who starred in the film, you know, the cabinet of Dr. Caligari. But that box full of nasty, creepy, crawly things.
Yeah, well, the inside of my mouth is like that.
I thought you were supposed to be on a diet, eh? I mean, Elsie's made a salad for your lunch, you know.
Has she? Yeah. I think I'll have it now. Where's Elsie? Elsie!
Morning, Mr. Malone.
Hello, love.
No sugar in yours.
Why not?
I thought you was cutting down.
Oh, no, not all the time. I only diet mealtime, see?
Over the downstairs door. Might be a case. I better go down and answer it. Will you carry on with the painting, Elsie?
Yeah.
Otherwise, you know, when it dries, these real nasty marks, you know.
I'm going shopping in a minute for your salad. I've ordered some peppers. Do you like green ones?
That's very nice.
They're only red ones that haven't ripened. Did you know that?
No, I didn't know that, no.
Yeah, some of my greengrocer says. Anyhow, he's going to hold on to them round the back for me.
Don't blame him.
Filthy old beggar outside. Says he's starving.
So am I. Got any biscuits, Elsie?
What about your diet?
Nah, it's not for 2 hours yet. Come on.
Look, listen, he hasn't eaten for 3 days.
Look, I haven't got any money.
It's not money that's bothering him. The reason he hasn't eaten for 3 days, he's broken his false teeth.
He's what?
He's broken his false teeth and wondering if we've got any super glue.
Oh, yeah. He's sniffing that, I shouldn't wonder. He wants to be careful about that. If you accidentally sit down on that sort of stuff, that is grounds for divorce, you know.
He's on the level, all right. Look, there you are. There they are there. Hey, see?
Oh, dear.
Yeah.
How do we know there is?
Well, he took them out of his mouth when I was standing there to polish them and they ate.
What else did he say?
Well, after taking his teeth out, I couldn't make out what he was on about.
He's having you on. I'll tell you what we'll do. We'll get him up here, see if they fit him.
That's a very good idea, Chip. Do you mind if I slip out this? And I was getting some very, very funny looks, you know, from the milkman.
There, that'll have to do for now. That's made me behind.
That's what?
That's put me behind on me ledger.
Here we are, there we are. This is, Mr. Malone?
How do you do?
You said it was a man, Charlie.
I beg your pardon?
You said it was a filthy old beggar with no teeth.
No, Chief, this is Mrs. Bumstead. She's a case.
I can see that. How do you go, Mrs. Hampstead? Sit down.
Bumstead.
Oh, well, whatever. Put it down there.
Now then, madam, what can we in the North West London Detective and Surveillance Bureau do for you?
What?
It's the new name, the North West London Detective and Surveillance Bureau. How about the cars printed?
Yeah, good. How many of these have had done?
Two, one each.
Where am I supposed to keep this? Down my trouser leg or what?
Mr. Maguire, there is no time to lose.
The name is Malone, Mrs. Bedstead.
Bumstead.
Exactly.
Please, let me explain my dilemma. I have a large ensemble and it's disappearing fast.
Oh, that's funny. The Chief's going on a diet today and all, right?
Ensemble? Music, you mean?
Precisely. A ladies' orchestra.
Oh, like the Ivy Benson band, you mean?
Well, hardly. We play light classical. And, of course, some genteel dance music for the captain when he has his parties aboard.
Captain? Aboard? Then this means it's a ladies' orchestra on a ship.
You are remarkably quick on the uptake, my good sir.
I'm surprising myself a bit this morning.
You say disappearing they are, then, to us.
Well, just vanishing one by one. I started off with 16. Now I'm down to 10. The last one to go was my alto saxophonist. A wonderful girl, devoted to her work. Sax mad she was. Lived for her instrument.
That's what I thought you said.
Something sinister is happening. Frankly, I suspect white slavers. Chinamen.
Chinamen are yellow, not white.
No, the girls they abduct are white. The actual slavers can be any colour, you see.
Oh, yeah.
See? Chinamen, eh? This gives it a sort of Far Eastern flavour then, doesn't it? Now, are these girls the sort of girls who would interest white slavers then?
Well, of course. All well-educated. And none of them older than me.
Well, they wouldn't have to be, wouldn't they? What? I mean, you wouldn't have to be well-educated. On the other hand, of course, I suppose it wouldn't matter at all, would it? You know?
Well, no. I mean, just because a girl plays a cello doesn't mean she's no good at anything else.
Precisely. In fact, with that sort of a training, she would be very well equipped to ride a motorbike, for instance.
Please, gentlemen, won't you help me? The ship is bound for Madeira, so it ought to be quite a pleasant cruise.
We don't know Madeira, do we?
No, I know their cake very well.
Your usual fee, of course.
All expenses paid?
Certainly.
Well, before we decide, have we got time to consider it?
As you wish.
I've already considered it.
So have I. We'll do it.
Splendid. I'll send the car around for you at 2:00. The boat sails this afternoon.
We'll be there.
Splendid. My girls will be most grateful. And I shall be delighted to welcome you to my happy circle.
Let's go.
See, only 10 left. My woodwind section is very much affected.
10? I can only see 9. Look, there's another one gone there.
Wait, heavens, Julia's gone, the trombonist. That knocks me right back on my brass as well. The best slide trombonist around.
Perhaps she just slid out for the loo.
Nonsense. She wouldn't go to the lavatory in the middle of an English country garden. No, she's been kidnapped like the rest. By now, she's probably in the back room of some dockside cafe. And we're about to sail. There's the signal.
Set sail, and with it, our two befuddled heroes. What will befall them on their voyage? Who is the sinister blind man? And what has happened to Mrs. Bumstead's woodwind section? Don't miss next week's exciting episode of Band of Slaves.
Thank you. Hello. Hello, Simon. Hello, Gerald here.
Hello, Doris. Doris, it's me, Walter.
How are you, old man?
All right, thanks.
Listen, Simon, I had to ring you up to find out how you got on with that fabulous new girl last night.
Not too bad. There were one or two things I couldn't quite get hold of.
Yes, I know the kind of girl, yes. Where did you take her? Somewhere exotic?
Sainsbury's.
Bianca Jagger goes there, doesn't she?
I think the best thing I can do, dear, is to go through the list with you.
Yes, yes, that's a good idea. So what was she like? I mean, what sort of girl?
A French bread.
Oh.
Bloomers too large.
Well, kept slipping down, you mean? Oh, well, if you will go ice skating, you will keep slipping down, won't you? Yeah.
And rolls for 20p.
She doesn't. What did you say her name was?
Hovis.
I think I know her. Listen, isn't she pregnant at the moment, though?
No current buns, dear. No, they've run out. A tin of something for the cat.
This all sounds very fishy to me, old sport. Very fishy indeed. Did you say her parents were in oil?
Yes, the Pilchards.
Well, she sounds a right little raver. I don't know how she had the energy.
She said the milkman hadn't been round yet.
Well, that would explain it, of course. Yeah. What did you do?
I had to get sterilised.
Good God.
To be on the safe side, I'll put them in the fridge when I get back.
Well, rather you than me, old chap.
Now, where was I?
So, she took you home and gave you a nightcap, did she? I
yes.
see.
Yes, dear.
What sort? What? Yes. Well, that sounds a bit of a puffy drink, old chap.
Was all she had, fairy liquid.
Oh, I see, I see. She had the bitter lemon and you had something stronger.
Yes, 3 tins of curry powder.
Yes, just to keep you going, eh? You lucky devil, I wish I'd been there. What sort of perfume was she wearing? Something really exotic.
Salt and vinegar. And smoky bacon.
Making a pig of herself, was she?
Oh, sorry, that was a mistake, dear.
She was what? Wearing a cross your heart bra?
I thought it said OXO.
I see, sir. So you naturally took the opportunity of having a quick...
Butchers, yes, dear, yes. Yes, yes, I didn't forget the steaks.
You saw her do what to the bra?
Fill it. With 2 portions of sirloin. Yes, I did make sure they were tender, dear, yes.
So I see you had her sitting there, nicely on the boil. Then what did you do?
I went across the road for some apples.
That's all you need, isn't it? I mean, that is all you need. A dog leaping up into your lap.
Yes, the crunchy sort. With the yellow skin, you know.
Golden retriever.
Golden delicious.
I bet he bites people, doesn't he?
And cocks his pippins.
Yes, I'm sure. What a terrible thing to happen. So what exactly did you say?
My 3 minutes is up. I'll have to go, dear.
That's about all you could say, I suppose.
Yes, dear.
Listen, you haven't told me yet, Simon, what this girl does for a living. What? She what? She works at Sainsbury's.
You forgot your champagne, Walter, darling.
That's for us, dear. Later.
I say, Simon, is this girl about 6 foot tall, blonde, big blue eyes and other things to match?
Look, dear, I'm going to be late. I've got a fair bit to see to.
I should forget it all, Simon. I'm sorry, old sport, you've been shortchanged. My little basket.
Gee, do you know anything that prevents baldness?
Only hair.
You're balding, lad?
No, me husband, it's all falling out.
Where? All over?
Yeah, all over the shag park carpet.
Since when have you had shag park carpet?
Ever since Harry's hair started falling all over.
You, Harry, always had nice wavy hair.
Yeah, well, it's waving goodbye now. The trouble is, he's growing very bushy elsewhere. I can't get near him. It's ruining our love life. Well, since he's grown this beard, he kisses me through a straw.
Here is a very funny story about a man who lives in Dagenham. It's not very funny so far, is it? And I speak with the voice of experience because I have just recently moved out of a house in Dagenham. Well, that place, it was too cramped for comfort. Every time the morning paper arrived, I went flying out the back window. And I have to be honest, it was something of a rough neighbourhood. we had to put a crook lock on the cat. I remember once the lady next door, this is the lady next door, once held a Tupperware party, and all police leave was cancelled. In fact, the crime rate was so high, there was a 6-month waiting list to get mugged. The neighbourhood, you can laugh, the neighbourhood was so tough that John Conti was our Avon lady. Now, fortunately, our new home is much nicer. I mean, I have to admit, the garden is a little bit overgrown. My wife was hanging out some washing yesterday, and 3 Japanese soldiers came out and surrendered. At the moment, she is unbelievably thin. With her tongue out, she looks like a zip. On Saturday, I decided to give her a hand with the housework, and that's where I made my big mistake. There I was in the kitchen, washing a few clothes out, and I fell into the tumble dryer. My 2 young children came in and thought they were watching Magic Roundabout. Luckily, I had my wits about me. I did 3 minutes of my cabaret act, and they got up and switched off. Understandably, I was still rather shaken the next day, and I went to see the producer of the show, you know, in the Oval Office. And as I walked in, he was sitting behind the desk, arranging a bunch of pansies. For a special he's doing with the Osmonds. Now, he put the phone down, he came over to me, he said to me, "What are you going to do for your little chatty poos tonight, lovey?" I didn't do that voice too often, I might get to like it. I said, "Well, actually, lovey, I'm going to do the one about the chap from Dagenham, which I happened to overhear in the BBC canteen at lunchtime, if you don't mind. I don't usually go to the BBC canteen today, but it's a special occasion, you know. They were presenting one of the sausage rolls, the gold watch." I overheard these two fellas talking. Now, one of them I knew quite well, the sort of bloke who's always trying to make a mountain out of a molehill, and Marty Kane's costume designer. And the other one was a producer, as a matter of fact, with BBC Scotland. Last I heard, he was due to make a new series about arts in Glasgow called Stitch That, Jimmy. Apparently, it never came off. The story goes, to be honest, that he annoyed Paul Daniels in the bar one day and spent 3 weeks inside a matchbox. This was the joke they were telling about a chap who lives in Dagenham. I don't ask me why he lives in Dagenham. There's now as queer as folk, as I always remember my Uncle Doris telling me. Shortly before he was cashiered from the Wrens. The important thing is that he is flying this plane in a solo flight round the world. Next to which the Dagenham bit is all a bit irrelevant. So, I don't know why I mentioned it. So off he goes on this solo flight in his lightweight Moulinex turboprop, and as luck would have it, a freak wind blows him off course, and he has to make a forced landing. Excuse me laughing, but I've heard it, you see. Has to make a forced landing, slap bang in the middle of the African jungle. "Blow it," he says. Or worse, that effect. Now I'm stranded. No food, no water supplies. Thank God I brought some luncheon vouchers. Suddenly, at that moment, there is a rustle. There's a rustle in the bushes, you see. And from out of the undergrowth steps this 7-foot-tall African native. Bone through the nose, shrunken heads hanging around his neck. I think he was from Dagenham as well. Carrying his hand a rude spear, which we won't dwell on. Well, naturally, the chap is just about to start saying his prayers when the native speaks to him. 7-foot-tall native says, "Pardon me, my good man, but I can't help noticing that you seem to be in some distress. I was therefore wondering whether I might perchance be of any assistance to you." The chap said, "Well, it is very kind," he said. The fellow said, "Not at all," he said. "I'm only too happy to water it." Doesn't half take it out of you. "In whatever way you desire." Well, at this point, the chap's curiosity gets the better of him. He said, "Look, excuse me for asking this," he said, "but here we are in the middle of the jungle. How is it you speak such immaculate English?" Well, the 7-foot-tall native said, "Well," he said, "as a matter of fact, sir, I picked it up on shortwave radio."
All our chums. I take philosophy as it comes.
I'm good at spelling and doing sums.
I'm terribly bright and frequently tight on Saturday night.
Well, in Latin and Greek are we.
I got a Master of Arts degree.
I got a bun and a cup of tea.
And now and again, a 10 out of 10 for filling his pen. I saw me tutor.
What did he say?
If you don't work for your BSc, you'll end up with BA.
So now we're up at Oxford and working wonders there.
I'm reading trigonometry.
And I'm reading Rupert Bear.
At breakfast time, the table's laid by Rosa Buxom, serving maid, who's over-large and underpaid and helps the students cram. Last Friday night, she lost her post. She burnt her boats on the breakfast toast, all because of a midnight raid and several undergrads who stayed for a go at her Oxford marmalade. And now she's in the jam.
Last Wednesday night, I saw the dean cast off his gown of bombazine, and in the buff, the daft old queen went dancing down the high, and every passerby could see his BTM and his PhD, and when I asked him where he'd been, he answered with a word obscene, which in the Greek I took to mean, go forth and multiply.
Arts. They knock off as soon as the bell goes.
In one of the people, there's masters of arts
who don't get their arts from their elbows.
St. Kitts is full of twits. There's lots of Swats and Merton. But for top marks, giggles and laughs, give us a girly from Gerda. Champagne when the party starts and Fred's well away with a couple of tarts.
And when first he sat on the primus, we said, by jingo, what fun. He's got jam, spam, overcooked ham and a hot cross bun.
Serving up the jelly nelly, custard all complete. Flustered in the melly, Nelly dropped it on my feet. She's a peach and cream complexion, and she trifles with affection. So I'll wear my Mac and welly, Nelly, if you will be my sweet. Taking tea with the girls are our varsity pals.
Doing parlor tricks, charming and balmy.
There's Nick with a trick, which he does with a brick. Two eggs and a stick of salami.
There's Algernon Hurst, the divinity first, with a party trick even uniquer. But he's hissed and he's booed as he stands in the nude, playing God Save the King on his squeaker.
And Gwendolyn's mad about men. You can tell she's a sport when you pour her a port. She's the sort that will always say when.
We quiz her again and again. She's the varsity challenges when.
Oh, the good times she's shown us when I got a bonus.
And I got a starter for 10.
What a day for a picnic. What a day for a do.
No shampoos for Fred. He can hardly walk.
He shouldn't bend down when they're popping a cork.
He staggered and sat on the cream cakes. We said, by jingo, how quaint. Now it's guess. Well, he's got an eclair, and he does feel faint.
On the banks of the river, each summer we see
picnickers, picnickers, picnickers.
Observing the boat race with crumpets and tea.
Picnickers, picnickers, picnickers.
Our homemade rosettes are of various blooms.
And our lady friends yell as their undies they lose.
Cos the crew's to a man when invited to choose.
Picnickers, picnickers, picnickers.
I'm an Oxford blue, and I do a little yachting. I'm an Oxford blue with a lady in the crew. I am often hugger-mugger with the lady in the lugger, but a punk's a little snugger for an Oxford.
I'm an Oxford blue with a pennant on me dinghy. I'm an Oxford blue, and I know a thing or two. When I cuddle little Guinness, I'm a menace in a pinnace, because I'm full of fun and Guinness. I'm an Oxford.
Party for tea at Oxford. We're tickled to be at Oxford. The summery days and the glimmer of the shimmery haze. Old Oxford, you fabulous town. Our Oxford, we'll never go down. Yes, Oxford, your dream is a green, and it's just like living in a dream. At the old Oxford, there's party for tea at Oxford. We're tickled to be at Oxford. The summery days and the glimmer of the shimmery haze.
Bring me on,
you fabulous town.
Bring me on.
Bring me on.
Well, that seems to be almost all we have time for tonight, doesn't it, Ronnie?
Yes, indeed it does. But before we go, a few late items of news. Lovejoy Sprigg, the Essex man who doesn't know the difference between a lie-down and a hoedown, was trampled to death tonight during the semi-final of Come Dancing.
Honeymooning lorry driver Sid Throstleby and his bride were rescued tonight from their hotel bedroom. Apparently the bed jackknifed as he was attempting a three-point turn.
Girling Pinnock, the trainee hermit from Hales Owen, this afternoon entered the third week of his training course for the solitary life. He's been standing on the terraces at Chelsea football ground.
There was a fire at the main Inland Revenue Office in London today, but it was put out before any serious good was done.
The attempt by Mr. Delmas Buckley to sail around the world in a bathtub ended in failure this morning. He'd only been at sea for 10 minutes when he had to get out and answer the phone.
Next week, I shall be telling you about an exciting innovation in the gardening world. Harry Smutters of Hendon has crossed a red-hot poker with a forget-me-not and come up with a painful reminder.
And in a packed programme, we shall be showing you the latest form of self-improvement. It involves a full-length mirror and a tin of varnish so you can gloss over your shortcomings.
Until then, it's good night from me.
And it's good night from him. Good night.
Good night. Good night.